clearly after this cold and some of the internet prices value sports then you don't know they know that they still want to be in it a whole lot cheaper than the new one. So that's not. And then when those get built up, people start spending money on the upgrade. You just kind of scratch your head, but you go, yeah, it's still cheaper than going out and buying one of those subdivisions that was lot 8,000-10,000 square feet, 6,000 square feet, and get mad. Closer to spend it. You got to open for it. You have to live in the city and not have to do any of it. So, I'm glad somebody wants to do that instead.
You know, in the house, you look at it, you look at it, you go on the ground and you go behind it. They have a road that's like 3 stories high.
Yeah.
I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea.
Surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of him beyond mortal ken, and I'm sure that he'd grant. Many places of beauty. to see here below. But time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew. While I stroll over heaven with you, I want to stroll.
Savior Jesus Christ, we are here today to honor and to celebrate the love, life, and the legacy of our dear brother Jerry Jefferson Lambert. And the family has prepared an order of service, and we will follow that order of service, beginning first with a musical selection from granddaughter Madison Ingle, followed by scripture, an Old Testament and New Testament reading, and a prayer of comfort.
Oh,
Amen. How great thou art. How great thou art. Our scripture reading from the Old Testament is going to be the 23rd Psalm. The 23rd Psalm. And the Word of God reads, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen. Our New Testament reading is coming from the Gospel of John, 14th chapter, beginning at verse number 1. "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his word. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we once again come before you, just acknowledging your goodness, acknowledging your greatness, acknowledging how awesome you are. We acknowledge that you are good even during times like this. You are good all the time. And we pray, Father God, right now for this family. We pray, Lord, that you will wrap your loving arms around them, that you will provide them comfort, that you will provide them strength during this difficult time. And Father, we pray, Lord, that you will help them as the days go forward with every decision that has to be made, with everything that needs to be done. Lord, be with them. You promised that you would be with us, that you would never leave us nor forsake us. So we pray, Father, that you would just touch this family in a special way and provide your rich comfort on each and every one. Lord, we pray that you will meet every need that they have at this time, Lord. We know, Lord, hearts are heavy. We know there's sorrow. But we also know that with you, Lord, there can be joy, that there can be strength. So, Father, we trust you, we honor you, and we adore you, Lord. And we leave everything to you. Because truly, God, if we give it to you, everything will be all right. So we thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. At this time, we're going to have another selection, and this is a special selection from Mama Lambert. And Mama Lambert, I'm told, is known for, as she spent many years teaching, she taught in high school, and she is known for leading every school year off with this song, Danny Boy. And I'm told that she would break out in song whenever she was asked. And I'm told that everyone remembered her for this talent that she had. And in particular, the only song I'm told that she sang was Danny Boy. So we're gonna be treated with another selection coming from Mama Lambert.
Thank you. you, Mama Lambert. Beautiful. At this time, we're going to pause for reflections. And our first reflection is going to come from another granddaughter, Morgan Engel. But we also want to invite anyone else that has a reflection or a tribute. If there are any words that you would like to say, we invite you to participate in the service in that way after Morgan's presentation.
Mama Lambert. I only remember her a little bit, but Papa would always say that every year in school, one of her biggest things she'd have them do is make a poem book. And they would have to pick a poem and recite it every year. And so he ended up growing to love poetry a lot. So I'm here to read his favorite poem. It's a classic by Robert Frost, The Road Not Taken. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveler long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference.
Amen. At this time, are there any other reflections or tributes that anyone would like to make? Extend that opportunity to you at this time.
Larry?
Yes.
Jerry was a gentle gentleman, and Jerry saved my life. Jim and I were having some financial problems. I was out of work, and one day he called me and he said, I want you to come to work at Chick-fil-A. I said, Jerry, what you got out of here for me? You got a nurse out there? There's nothing out there for me. He said, you come and talk with me. Just come in. I said, well, now I'll go. But I don't know of anything I can do out here. But I spent about 25 years out there. And I just attribute that to him. He said he was standing in the shower. I attribute it to God.
Yes.
Because he said, I was standing in the shower and you came across my mind.
Wow.
That's God's hand in things. And I just would never be able to pay that debt to him. I just thank him so much for that.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Is there another? Amen.
One of Miss Lambert's favorite poems was, the woods are lovely, dark and deep,
else have something on your heart at this time?
I just want to say that we have over a dozen of our high school classmates here paying tribute to Jerry.
Mm-hmm.
And we all remember Mrs. Lambert and her Danny Boy songs and all those poems. And he was a fine man, and we will all miss him greatly.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
You know, we all love Miss Lambert. She was a wonderful person, a wonderful teacher. But we love Jarius equally. He was my neighbor right across the street.
Mm-hmm.
And he would always tell me, you better make sure you close your blinds now. Rebecca and I would go over. We'd pick cotton for him in the summer. We grew up together.
Yes.
He was a few years older than we were, but we loved Jerry and we had some good times with him.
Yes, yes. Thank you. Thank you. If there's not another, at this time we're going to have a silent reading of the obituary. Amen. Amen. At this time, we'll have another musical selection from Madison Engel, and following that, we'll have the eulogy.
Wish I could see the angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high on that mountain. Son, your work on earth is done. Go to
praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Once again, on behalf of myself and my wife Barbara in her absence, our condolences go out to Kathy and Michael, Alan and Soyla, to the grandchildren, Morgan, Madison, Haley, Andrew, Maya, Mason. We extend our condolences to you, this wonderful family, and even those who are about to come into the family, Brad and Luke. Yes. We know that this is a difficult time, and it's never easy to get through a day like today. But we just want you to know that the Lord will bring you through, because he's promised never to leave us nor forsake us. So let us pray. Dear Lord, we gather here today acknowledging that you are God Almighty. We acknowledge that you are the creator and the sustainer of all things. All life is in your hands. We pray, Lord, that your blessings will be on this ongoing service. We pray, Lord, that you will allow your presence to be felt, that you will bring comfort to those who mourn, and that your spirit would move in all of us at this time. We pray, Lord, that you would just bless this time that we're together. In Jesus' name, amen. We're all going to miss Jerry. But 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 reminds us that as believers, we sorrow, But we don't sorrow like those who have no hope, because our hope is in Jesus. Our hope is in a glorious future with Jesus Christ. So we might have tears, but if you are a believer, there can be joy inside those tears. And we have joy because just as Jesus died and was resurrected, we know that as believers, one day we too will be resurrected. And Scripture also tells us that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So Jerry's body is here, but his soul is with Jesus. And for that, we can say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, I shouldn't be surprised, but I just marvel at how God just orchestrates the events in our life. He puts certain people in your path over the years, and somehow some of those connections that we make and some of those relationships that we form stick and last for years and years. And then there are others that just kind of fade away. Jerry and I go back over 40 years. Wow, 40 years. Jerry interviewed and hired me back in 1980 to work at Chicopee as a personnel assistant. I was telling Kathy and Alan about this. And I still remember the interview that I had for that job at Chicopee, because during the interview, Jerry showed me this stack of binders and books and pamphlets and folders that must have been about this high. And he tells me this is what other candidates have submitted, works that they have written, things that they have published, things that they wanted to submit to show that they were good candidates for this job, examples of their worthiness. And when I heard that, I was like, oh well, I'll never work here because I don't have anything like that. But I got the job. I got the job. And it was something special because the very first assignment that Jerry gave me in my new job as a personnel assistant at Chicopee was to write the letters to the people that did not get the job. And I was like, very professional and very diplomatic when I wrote the letters. But what I wanted to say was, nah, 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 I got the job and you didn't. And I thought that was a very creative thing for Jerry to do, a very creative first assignment for him to give somebody. And I always thought that Jerry was very creative. Jerry was always thinking about something. He was always doing something. He was always willing to try new things. And he always encouraged me to do the same thing. And our friendship grew and grew over the years. Beyond what work we did at Chicopee, I even worked with him and Barbara in their photography business. Jerry taught me photography. He taught me photography. And all I needed to do was, all I did was express that I had an interest in learning more about photography. And he said, okay, have at it. And he took me under his wing, he showed me the ropes, and he got me started in photography and working with him. I even started my own photography business. And that's just the way Jerry was. He was one of the most encouraging and influential people in my life. I learned so much from him, not just about our shared profession and human resources or about photography, but I learned so much about life just being around Jerry. Because he seemed to know a little bit about everything, or at least he had an opinion about it. He had a way of talking with you that immediately put you at ease. He could talk to anybody, and he developed many, many friendships. So Jerry leaves a rich legacy where he touched many lives, either through his family, whom he loved dearly, from Chicopee, from photography, or through his travels with his soulmate, Barbara. Jerry was one of those unique individuals that God puts in your path to impact your life in a special way. And I thank God for that. I thank God for that. Jerry was a talker. He was a talker. He could tell you some of the funniest and most entertaining stories about his life, about his experiences, and sometimes even about other people's lives that would just draw you in and sometimes could have you rolling on the floor in laughter. And he was a great writer also, a great writer. I think he got that from Mama Lambert. And I believe his greatest writing, the greatest writing that he ever did, were those cancer updates that he sent out in emails periodically. That first were him chronicling Barbara's health situation, and then he chronicled his own health situation. They were so well written, so impactful, that I kept every last one of those. I still have them. And at the end of those updates, he would have this tag that said, live hard, love hard, pray hard. Live hard, love hard, pray hard. And I don't know where it came from. All I know is that this was wisdom from Jerry. And it's true, we do need to live hard, love hard, and pray hard. Especially when you think about the time that we're living in today, with the pandemic, with all the concerns, with the division all over the country, and with the uncertainty that we have, we ought to live hard, love hard, and pray hard. And you know what? I think there's a message in that tag that he had in his emails, and I want to share that with you. First, live hard. Live hard. In the Bible, Matthew chapter 6, verse 34, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own thing. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. In other words, live for today. Live life to the fullest as unto the Lord, because tomorrow is not promised to anyone. Why worry about tomorrow when there are things that you can impact today? There are things you can do today. And Jerry lived a full life. He worked hard, always doing something, always busy, and he lived hard, meaning he knew the value of taking time to enjoy life. And sometimes we forget that God wants us to enjoy life. Jesus came not only to give us life, but he came to give us life more abundantly. For Jerry, that abundant life was spending as much time as he could with his family, with his friends, laughing together, playing together, enjoying meals together. It was all the time he spent with Barbara, camping and traveling all across the country and in different countries. It was the time he spent at his place in Emerald Isle. It was the time he spent fishing. It was the time he spent listening to bluegrass music and going to festivals and all the other things that he enjoyed. He took the time to enjoy the fruits of his labor. Jerry loved life and he lived hard. And it's important that we enjoy the time that we spend on this earth, but we got to know that that's not all that there is. That's not all there is. There is much more waiting for those of us who believe in Jesus. Love hard. Love hard. John 15, 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Jesus commands us to love one another. And if we can love each other as Jesus loved us, that's loving hard. That's loving hard, because Jesus loves us hard. His love is genuine, his love is unlimited, and his love is unconditional. Jesus loves us with an everlasting love. And our minds are not even capable of fully understanding all the love and how much Jesus loves us. He died for us. And the Bible says, who can separate us from the love of Christ. No one and nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. And the Bible says that if we belong to Christ, no one can snatch us out of his hand. That's love. And we feel happy, we feel thrilled, we feel excited, we feel complete, we feel blessed when people love us, don't we? Love is maybe the most important part of who we are. And I know Jerry loved her. He absolutely loved Barbara, his high school sweetheart and wife of 49 years. Barbara was the center of his life, and he missed her so much after she passed away. Genuine, unlimited, unconditional love. It was a beautiful love story that I had the privilege and opportunity to witness on many occasions. And Jerry absolutely loved you all, his family. Genuine, unlimited, unconditional was the love that Jerry had for all of you. If Barbara was the center of his life, then you all were like the spokes in the wheel of his life. And Jerry loved others. He loved others. He told me once that he wasn't a groupie person, that he was more of a loner. But so many people called him friend. He was a friend to many, myself included. And I know this because of his concern for others. I know this because of the advice that he would give others. I know this for how much he helped other people out from time to time. He told us, don't worry about the small and insignificant stuff. He said, it's not even worth the adrenaline. He said, don't hold grudges, because grudges will make you sick. And you need to forgive, and you need to forget. And if you do, you won't regret it. And he said, for your mental health, Jerry said it was important to go out and make new friends, meet new people, learn some new skills, play games, listen to music, dance, laugh a lot. Get out and do things. And after Barbara died, and while his health allowed him, he made a goal to try to help other people, especially those who lost a spouse, just like he did. That was Jerry. He loved hard. And then there's pray hard. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. And I like the way the New Living Translation renders this. And it goes, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. That's praying hard. That's praying hard. When you pray, this is your conversation with Almighty God. When you read the Bible, that's his conversation with you. And this is the formula for every relationship. Every relationship, we have to communicate with each other, right? How else do you get to know someone unless you communicate with someone? Without some sort of back and forth communication, how would couples ever fall in love? Without some sort of back and forth communication, there would be no marriages. Without some sort of back and forth communication, no one would ever have any friends. You have to communicate with each other. Every relationship starts by talking to each other. And when you pray and pray hard, you actually communicate with and develop a connection with the God of the universe. Almighty God, the creator and sustainer of everything. And God is the God who knows you better than you know yourself. He knows you better than anyone else. And the Bible says that he knows the very hairs on your head. And even though God already knows you and already knows how you're doing, he wants you to communicate with him He wants us to pray hard to him. He wants to hear about all of our fears, all of our doubts, all of our worries, all of our frustrations, all of our hurts, all of our pains. He wants to hear us confess our wrongs and ask for forgiveness. And he patiently waits for us to ask him to provide for us. And this scripture says that if we do this, he's going to give us peace. Peace. And not just any kind of peace. He says it's a peace that goes beyond anything that we can understand. And that's why we need to pray hard. Because prayer changes everything. Prayer changes everything. And if nothing else, prayer will change you. Prayer will change how you look at things. Prayer will change how you look at your circumstances. Prayer will change how you look at life itself. The wisdom of Jerry reminds us to pray hard. But you know what? I believe there's another piece to live hard, love hard, pray hard. And this piece is one that Jerry probably couldn't write about for himself. And that last piece is finish strong. Finish strong. So it's live hard, love hard, pray hard, finish strong. Jerry would say, because life is short, and it is. The Bible says that life is like a vapor. It's like a fog. It comes in and appears for a little while, and then it goes away. And 78 years is no time at all. It's a short time when you think about the eternal economy of God. So if you make the most of the short time that you're here on this earth, if you live hard, if you love hard, if you pray hard, you can have a strong finish. Jerry Jefferson Lambert had a strong finish. How many of you know that it's not how you start, but it's how you finish that counts? Jerry had a strong finish because of the 78 years of legacy he was blessed to create. His true legacy, y'all, his true legacy is not based on any material possessions that he had. His true legacy is not based on any accomplishments he may have made in his professional life or in the several businesses that he owned. His true legacy is you. You are his true legacy. God blessed him to have you, this beautiful, beautiful family, and how through you, his legacy is going to continue. Praise God. Jerry's true legacy is in every person whose life he touched along the way. With Jerry, what you see is what you get. I'm among the many, many recipients of Jerry just being Jerry. Just being himself and having this profound impact on my life and on the life of many, many others. Yes, Jerry had a strong finish because Jerry was a fighter. Ever since his health began to fail about 7 years ago, he was committed to living hard, loving hard, and praying hard. And after his physical health became limited, it reminded me of this scripture, 2 Timothy 4, verse 6. The time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Yes, a strong finish. After all the doctors, after all the hospital stays, after all the surgeries, after all the treatments, after all the medicines, Jerry had a strong finish. And I don't mean he was strong physically, because over these years, his physical appearance changed. His illness actually made him weaker physically. So he wasn't strong physically, but he was strong spiritually. And that's what makes a strong finish, because that's what's going to sustain you. That's what's going to keep you. That's what's going to hold you in times of trouble, times of stress, times of issues of life, circumstances of life. That faith is what's going to be constant and what's going to sustain you. God says that in our human strength, we will never be strong enough to get through all the challenges and all the difficulties that we face in life. But God says His strength, not our strength, His strength is made perfect in our weakness. When I spoke to Jared on the phone a week ago today, we talked about the Lord. Jared told me that he knew Jesus. Jared told me that he's always known Jesus. What a blessing that is. What a testimony that is. He knew that in this time of departure, he knew that that time of departure was at hand. And he was at peace after years of fighting the good fight. He was at peace with finishing this race called life. And because of that statement of faith, I know where Jerry is right now. We are thankful today that God loaned us Jerry for 78 years because he was never ours. He never belonged to us. And this was never his home. He belonged to God, and right now, his home is in heaven. So we're thankful today for the time that we've had with Jerry. We're thankful for his time as a husband. We're thankful for his time as a father, as a grandfather, and as a good friend. We're thankful for all the memories that he gave us that we can cherish. And we can take comfort in the truth of God's word from Revelation chapter 21. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. The Bible declares that there is a place called heaven, and it is a place where there is no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying, and no more pain. This is Jerry's home now. So we're going to miss Jerry, but Jerry's doing all right. Jerry has a new life. Jerry has a new body. And Jerry has a new home beyond 303 North Lincoln Street. I envision him being reunited with Barbara, being reunited with Mom and Pop Lambert, with Billy Royce, and with in-laws, and all of them telling him, welcome home, welcome home. And Mama Lambert singing Danny Boy, not as a recording, but live and in person. Hallelujah. What a joy that is. What a comfort that is, and what reassurance that is for all of us. So we praise God today. We celebrate this homegoing of our dear friend, Jerry Lambert. He lived hard, he loved hard, he prayed hard, and he finished strong. May God keep you, and may heaven smile upon you. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Once again, Father God, we come before you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for who you are. We thank you that you are the God of comfort. And Lord, we look to you right now to bring comfort to each and every heart. Bless us, Lord, as only you can, in the name of Jesus. Have your way in our lives going forward. And Lord, our prayer is that you will be with this family when all the visitation stops, when all the calls stop, when the cards stop. Be with them, Lord. And Lord, we pray that you will have them to feel your presence in everything that they do. We pray, Lord, that you will just fill any gaps, any holes in their heart right now with your rich love and with your rich mercy and with your rich comfort. Bless them, Lord, as only you can. And Lord, we thank you for this time that we've had. We pray, Lord, for each and every one of us, that as we go forth from this day, that you will be our guiding light, that you will continue to guide us and direct our paths, that you will have your way in each and every one of our lives, and have us to be the people that you have called us to be. This is our prayer, in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand. Everyone except the family, please stand.
He looked down into her brown eyes and said, say a prayer for me. She threw her arms around him, whispered, God.